Good morning. Welcome to the Sunday worship service. We'll begin the service with prayer. Let me pray. Most gracious Heavenly Father, thank you so much for sending your one and only Son, Jesus Christ, to save us from the power of sin and death. Thank you so much for giving us the words of God from Mark's Gospel. Father, especially today's passage, Jesus' prayer at Gethsemane, not my will, but yours be done. Through this, Jesus made his decision and direction to go to the cross to die for the sins of the world. Jesus won the spiritual battle to face the cross. Father, be with us at this time through the presence of the Holy Spirit and bless today's worship. Bless all attendants here in person and online, that we may prepare our hearts to receive your words. Also bless Pastor John with a powerful message through the help of the Holy Spirit. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. So for today's worship service, we started a little bit late because of some technical issues, but welcome to everybody. Moses is not here today to lead the praise, so we have no praise time today, but we're going to sing hymn songs instead, okay? So, first hymn song, number 2. Thank you. And now we'll have prayer from Juan Perez.
Okay, let us pray. Dear most gracious Heavenly Father, thank you, Lord, for your amazing grace and love upon our lives. Thank you, Lord, for giving us this time to gather here at church and at home to praise and worship your name. Thank you, Lord, for calling us out of darkness to see your glory and really have a new life. Lord, thank you for your words last week where you shared with your disciples, "This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many." Lord, thank you for reminding us that you pour out your blood for us so we can reestablish our relationship with our Heavenly Father. Lord, may those words really resonate 2,000 years from the time you said it, and may our hearts be softened and really value the sacrifice that you made for us on the cross. Help us, Lord, to really value our relationship with you above anything else. Especially help us, Lord, to find the strength that we need to deal with this pandemic. Especially remember those who are in the front lines, all the nurses, all the doctors who are on a daily basis putting their lives at risk to save many lives. May this life be safe, not just physically, but also spiritually. And please be with them to also share the spiritual life that you have given them, especially those who are serving you through these difficult times. Lord, may you also remember your faithful servants here in the U.S. and also all over the world who are, despite the pandemic, they continue to make an effort to bring salvation to all those people who are lost. May your precious word continue to be a source of blessing to many, even with the many restrictions that we are bondaged by at this time. Please give us the wisdom to be a source of light in this darkness that we are experiencing because of this virus. And help us, Lord, to have your message be spread even more, and may it resonate in our hearts even louder. Help us, Lord, also to be mindful of each other, especially be helpful to those who are in need for your in need, and those who are suffering because they cannot fulfill their basic needs. May we continue to provide the support they need in any way that you put in our hearts. Lord, may your word continue to lead our lives in a daily basis. Help us, Lord, to put you first in everything we do. May your word be the source of guidance that we follow, especially as we go through this new normal that we're experiencing. Help us, Lord, to use this experience for your glory and not just give in to the painful changes that it has brought to many of us. Lord, may your word continue to be preached. I pray, Lord, for Pastor John's message to be powerful, and may your spirit be upon him as he deliver it to us. May we be moved by your words that you're sharing through his message. May you continue to empower him to lead this ministry and have the strength that is needed to pray for all of us and continue to be a good example for us to follow. May you continue to give him physical and spiritual strength on a daily basis to be your precious instrument to lead, be a light for our ministry. Please be with each and every one of us and help us, Lord, to put everything aside and listen to your words that you are about to share with us. Help us, Lord, to really embrace them and take one word to our hearts through this message. I thank you, Lord, for this beautiful time that we have to hear your message, and I pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Now we have just a few announcements. The HBF Summer Bible Conference will be held online from July 30th, Thursday, to August 1st, Saturday. So please pray for the conference. Also, we have a fellowship leaders and committee chairs meeting next Sunday at 3 p.m. online. And next week's messenger will be Pastor John. Now at this time, we'll have Bible reading. Let's look at the passage, and I will read through. You will all fall away, Jesus told them, for it is written, I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep will be scattered. But after I have risen, I will go ahead of you into Galilee. Peter declared, even if all fall away, I will not. Truly I tell you, Jesus answered, today, yes, tonight, before the rooster crows twice, you yourself will disown me three times. But Peter insisted emphatically, even if I have to die with you, I will never disown you. And all the others said the same. They went to a place called Gethsemane, and Jesus said to his disciples, sit here while I pray. He took Peter, James, and John along with him, and he began to be deeply distressed and troubled. My soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death, he said to them. Stay here and keep watch. Going a little further, he fell to the ground and prayed that, if possible, the hour might pass from him. Abba, Father, he said, everything is possible for you. Take this cup from me. Yet not what I will, but what you will. Then he returned to his disciples and found them sleeping. Simon, he said to Peter, are you asleep? Couldn't you keep watch for 1 hour? Watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. Once more, he went away and prayed the same thing. When he came back, he again found them sleeping because their eyes were heavy. They did not know what to say to him. Returning the third time, he said to them, are you still sleeping and resting? Enough. The hour has come. Look, the Son of Man is delivered into the hands of sinners. Rise, let us go. Here comes my betrayer. And now we'll have the message from Pastor John.
Good morning. The title for today's passage is Jesus the Shepherd. Key verse comes from verse 27. I'll read this verse by myself. It all fall away, Jesus told them, for it is written, I will strike the shepherd and the sheep will be scattered. Let's pray. Father in heaven, thank you for sending Jesus as our Lord and Savior. Thank you for blessing us to worship together through online. Father, may your name be glorified through our worship service, and you may speak to us very personally. I thank you. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Last Sunday, we learned Jesus, the teacher. As the teacher, Jesus revealed that he had a super knowledge, and he loved Judas Iscariot, revealing the truth that God's sovereign plan will succeed. And he taught them he is the Passover lamb who came to give his body and blood. Today's passage shows Jesus as the shepherd. As a shepherd, Jesus did three things in today's passage. First, Jesus predicted the failure of his disciples and planted hope in them. And secondly, Jesus showed the example of prayer of trial at the time of trial. And lastly, Jesus kept encouraging his disciples to watch and pray. My message is three parts. Part one, but after I have risen, I will go ahead of you into Galilee. This part, as the shepherd, Jesus predicted their failure and planted hope in them. Part two, he fell to the ground and prayed. This part, as the shepherd, he showed the example of prayer. Part three, watch and pray. As a shepherd, he kept encouraging his disciples to watch and pray. So part one, after I have risen, I will go ahead of you into Galilee. I'll read verses 27 through 31. You all fall away, Jesus told them, for it is written, I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep will be scattered. But after I have risen, I will go ahead of you into Galilee. Peter declared, even if all fall away, I will not. Truly I tell you, Jesus answered, today, yes, tonight, before the rooster crows twice, you yourself will disown me three times. But Peter insisted emphatically, even if I have to die with you, I will never disown you. And all the others said the same. So this is the after the Passover meal. Jesus was saying to them, you will all fall away, for it is written, I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep will be scattered. Jesus quoted this verse from Zechariah. The part of the quotation came from God's judgment of wrath for people by striking the shepherd. So it was fitting this quotation because Jesus' crucifixion is expression of God's wrath and judgment against sin of man. So Jesus was predicting their failure. You will all fall away. Because it is written, I will strike the shepherd and the sheep will be scattered. Jesus predicted their failure not to encourage them to despair, but to know their failure and not to despair. And then Jesus planted hope of restoration immediately after the verse 28. But after I have risen, I will go ahead of you into Galilee. Jesus was saying, that is not the end of the story. He will rise from the dead, and he will go ahead of them into Galilee, and he will wait for them to come and start a new beginning. So Jesus' words, but after I have risen, I will go ahead of you into Galilee, made a failure of his disciples not as failure, but a process and step of victory. As I shared in the past, Thomas Edison invented the light bulb through more than 1,000 times of experiment. So when journalists asked him, how could you overcome more than 1,000 times of failure? Edison answered, I never failed. I just went through more than 1,000 times of steps or process. Jesus said, but after I have risen, I will go ahead of you into Galilee. You'll all fall away, you'll all be scattered, but it doesn't matter. It's not a real failure, but it's a step and process for a glorious victory in Galilee. But in verse 29, Peter declared, even if all fall away, I will not. Peter did not think about much when Jesus said, but after I have risen, I will go ahead of you into Galilee. If Peter had thought about what Jesus said in verse 29, he would have questions, where in Galilee? What do you want to do with us at there? But he did not even think about verse 28. And he said only he remembered, I will strike the shepherd and the sheep will be scattered and you'll all fall away. And he said, not me. Even if all fall away, I will be an exemption. I will be an exception. And Jesus said in verse 30, truly I tell you, Jesus answered, today, yes, tonight, before the rooster crows twice, you yourself will saw me three times. It's about in 6 hours, Peter will disown Jesus three times. Jesus was very honest. Jesus told him his failure in advance. But Peter was so confident in his willpower. In verse 31, he insisted emphatically, even if I have to die with you, I will never disown you. No problem. He was so confident on himself. When the other 10 disciples heard what Peter said, they were compelled to say the same thing. And all the others said the same. Even if I have to die with you, I will never disown you. So this part of the passage shows Jesus the shepherd who predicted their failure, but at the same time planted the hope of a restoration. Part two, he fell to the ground and prayed. As a shepherd, Jesus showed the example of prayer in the time of trial to his disciples. I'll read verse 32 through 36. They went to a place called Gethsemane, and Jesus said to his disciples, sit here while I pray. He took Peter, James, and John along with him, and he began to be deeply distressed and troubled. My soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death, he said to them. Stay here and keep watch. Going a little further, he fell to the ground and prayed that if possible the hour might pass from him. Abba, Father, he said, everything is possible for you. Take this cup from me, yet not what I will, but what you will. So Jesus and his disciples went to the place called Gethsemane, and Jesus said to 11 disciples, sit here while I pray. But then, verse 33, he took Peter, James, and John, the three top disciples, along with him, and he began to be deeply distressed and troubled. Bible shows Jesus took Peter, James, and John some cases. For example, when he went to raise up Nazareth, Jairus' daughter, he took Peter, James, and John. When he went to the Mount of Transfiguration, he took Peter, James, and John. Now, in this time of prayer, he took Peter, James, and John. And he began to be deeply distressed and troubled. So far, Jesus was victorious. He resolutely headed for Jerusalem. He taught his disciples three times he will suffer and be killed and rise again. But at this time, within about several hours before he was arrested and tried and crucified, he began to be deeply distressed and troubled. And he said, verse 34, my soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death. He said to them, stay here and keep watch. He was talking about overwhelming sorrow to the point of death. So he was so overwhelmed with the sorrow to the point of death. If an ordinary person faces this kind of situation, there are usually three things they may do. First, they may commit suicide because they could not bear such a sorrow, overwhelming sorrow and pain. They would just end their lives. Second possibility is they would be nervous breakdown and mentally ill because this pain and sorrow is beyond what they can bear. They can bear, so they may be nervous breakdown. And another possibility is, out of this stress, sorrow, and pain of death, they may go to crazy things, such as taking drugs or watching pornos or gambling or drinking a lot or chasing after women and so on and so forth. Overwhelming sorrow and the pain of death. In his entire life, he never shared such a trouble in his life very personally. But he did not hide his weakness and humanity to his disciples. He shared with them and he showed the example of prayer even at this time of overwhelming sorrow and the pain of death. He did not run away from pain and sorrow, but rather, going a little further in verse 35, he fell to the ground and prayed. He fell to the ground and prayed that if possible, the hour might pass from him. The hour is the hour of God's wrath against all the sin of man. Verse 36, Abba, Father. Abba is the intimate term of calling God like a daddy. Everything is possible for you. Truly, everything is possible for God, the Creator. Take this cup from me, the cup of suffering and death. This is what Jesus wants. Who wants to take the cup of suffering and death, being crucified and hung on a cross several hours? Yet not what I will, but what you will. This is the final prayer. So Jesus' prayer was the time to submit his will to the will of his Father and receive the strength to obey the will of his Father. There are many kinds of prayers. For example, we can offer our prayer of thanks and praising God. We can praise God and we can give thanks to God. It will not be difficult. The other times you offer a prayer of asking, please provide me a food, or please bless my children, many things. Also, this may not be that difficult because we offer our prayer of what we want or asking. But Jesus' prayer, not what I will, but what will, is kind of highest form of prayer because he was denying what he wants following what God wants. What Jesus wants, what Jesus willed, was to save his life. What God willed, to give up his life or sacrifice his life. So this kind of prayer to deny what we will, but do what God will, is kind of highest form of prayer. Mostly, as a shepherd, Jesus showed very vivid example of prayer at the time of crisis without hiding at all to his disciples. He showed an example in this time of stress and difficulty and trial, he showed the example to pray instead of doing crazy things. Part 3, watch and pray. I'll read verses 37 through 42. Then he returned to his disciples and found them sleeping. Simon, he said to Peter, are you asleep? Couldn't you keep watch for 1 hour? Watch and pray so that you not fall into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. Once more he went away and prayed the same thing. When he came back, he again found them sleeping because their eyes were heavy. They did not know what to say to him. Returning the third time, he said to them, are you still sleeping and resting? Enough. The hour has come. Look, the Son of Man is delivered into the hands of sinners. Rise, let us go. Here comes my betrayer. When I read this passage, one question arose in my heart. It was the most trial time of Jesus Christ, but Jesus bothered himself so much to come to his disciples, kept encouraging them to keep to watch and pray even three times. This was very unusual to me. If it's a normal times, it would be okay. I could understand that Jesus wanted to teach them how to pray. But it was such a trial time of Jesus. When Jesus was bearing overwhelming sorrow and death, but he kept coming to his disciples and encouraging them to watch and pray. And then to me, this is none other than Jesus the shepherd, who kept encouraging his disciples watch and pray so that they will not fall into temptation. We have temptation all the time. If you do not want to have any temptation, you need to go to the moon. Every human being have temptation all the time. The issue is, will you fall into temptation or not? Falling into temptation is actually being tempted. We all have temptation. And Jesus said to Simon Peter, verse 38, watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation. He picked up Simon Peter because he is the one who emphatically claimed, declared, even if all had to fall away from you, I will not. Even if I have to die with you, I will never disown. And Jesus said to Simon, watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation. Jesus asked Simon to pray, not for Jesus, but Simon himself. Simon, you need to watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation. But three times they failed. They were exhausted, they were tired, they were sorrowful, so they all fell into sleeping. Jesus' intensive care and encouraging, even to the last moment, for his disciples as the shepherd. Then this is verse 42. Jesus said, rise, let us go. Here comes my betrayer. What Jesus said here is very different from what he said before he started to pray. Verse 34, my soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death. This is what he said before he prayed. And verse 42, rise, let us go. Here comes my betrayer. This is what he said after he offered prayer. Before he offered the prayer, he was overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death. He was miserable. He was so weak. He was so powerless. But after three times of prayer, he was victorious. Rise, let us go. Here comes my betrayer. I'm ready to be delivered into the hands of sinners. Jesus was already victorious. Even before he was arrested and tried and crucified, through prayer, he had already won the victory. This is the power of prayer. And Jesus wanted his disciples to experience such a power of prayer in their lives. So as a shepherd in today's passage, Jesus predicted their failure and planted hope of restoration. As a shepherd, Jesus showed the practical example of prayer at the time of trial. And lastly, as a shepherd, Jesus kept encouraging his disciples to watch and pray so that they will not fall into temptation. And Jesus himself practically showed the power of prayer in his practical lives. We all want to pray and live a victorious life. All believers know the power of prayer in their practical lives because we all experience difference when we pray. But like disciples, from time to time, we fail to pray. So I was thinking about what can help us to pray following Jesus' disciples. Number one, as Jesus said, when he failed to pray, we should not despair, but rather what Jesus said, but after I have risen, I will go ahead of you into Galilee. There will be a time of restoration. There will be a help of Jesus, and keep trying. Another thing I found is there is a difference between Jesus and his disciples at the time of Gethsemane prayer. There is one thing Jesus had and Jesus' disciples did not have. Do you know what it is? I know it's a challenging question, but still I ask you. There is one thing Jesus had, but his disciples did not have at the time of Gethsemane prayer. I know you're all home, but try to answer the question. And I found, did you answer your question? You can answer silently. Well, you cannot think about it, that's fine. The answer is the Holy Spirit. When Jesus was baptized, the Holy Spirit came upon him like a dove. Jesus' disciples at the time of Gethsemane did not receive the Holy Spirit yet. What I am saying is this. Jesus, the Good Shepherd, wanted to help his disciples to watch and pray, so later he came to them through Holy Spirit, and he began to dwell inside of them. So Jesus, as a shepherd, extended his service and encouragement, empowerment, planting the hope of restoration through his presence. He came to dwell inside of his disciples, and that was only possible after he denied his will and followed the will of God and to be crucified. These days we have Galatians Daily Bread. As you read it, as I read it, the greatest gift that we receive from God by believing Jesus Christ, justification by faith in Jesus Christ, is the Holy Spirit. So Jesus as a shepherd came to all believers in the form of a Holy Spirit and kept encouraging us to watch and pray in the time of trials. And how can he keep on praying? And another idea came to my mind. I'll read this. This is someone said, it's not easy. If it was easy, there would be no Kerry Washington. If it was easy, there would be no Tara G. Hansen. If it was easy, there would be no Octavia Spencer. But not only that, if it was easy, there would be no Viola Davis. If it is easy, there would be no Michael T. Williamson, no Stephen McKinney Henderson, no Russell Hornsby. If it was easy, there would be no Denzel Washington. Do you know who said this? This is what Denzel Washington said, and it's the commencement and one of the universities, the graduation. And I didn't pay attention to the whole thing, but what to me, this is how I interpret. Since I did not watch the whole thing, I don't know if it is correct or not. What Denzel Washington was saying is, in order to be successful, we need to have commitment and concentration, I think. But that's not easy. That's what he was saying. But what he was trying to say, to my understanding, because it was not easy, they grew through challenges and difficulties. And easy could be more harm than difficulties to make progress or hardship. Easy could be more threat than hardship to make progress. Now, in order to pray, we need to start from small things. If you are able to pray 1 minute, I know one person in my booklet, this is what she said. God, sometimes I don't know whether you are there or not. Please help me to believe you are there and help me. That's one of her prayer. So we all have different degree of prayer. So if you can pray maybe 10 seconds or half an 10 seconds like this person, that's fine. If you're able to pray 5 minutes, that's fine. But you need to start to pray. It requires discipline, consistency. And then if you keep on praying, you will experience the joy of prayer, and your time of prayer will increase more and more. So, but when we wanted to learn prayer in an easy way, it will not work out. Prayer does not come automatically. Think about school study. You learn English. Did English come to your mind automatically? No. You have to memorize vocabularies. You have to learn it. School studies. You have to read books. You have to write papers. You have to listen to the lectures. We wanted to pray and experience a victory from God. We need to make an effort. If you want to make it easy, that's one of the reasons we may fail. He said all these actors and actresses, it was not easy for them to overcome themselves and be a good and famous actors and actresses. So, in order for us to grow in prayer and experience the power of prayer, let us remember Jesus came to us as the shepherd and live inside of us, empower us, encourage us, planting hope of restoration continually. Jesus' disciples failed miserably at the Mount of Gethsemane. But when you read the book of Acts, they were able to pray, they were victorious, and they were even encouraged the people to pray, and they experienced the power from prayer. So they grew in prayer from people who failed to pray to people who were able to pray. This is the hope and vision for Christ to have for all of us. All of us may fall away from time to time, but Christ has hope for us because he wants to help us to grow, and we are willing to take his encouragement and grow. I will share one of my stories. My most trial time as a believer, I had a most difficult time with two people, and I had to deal with them. And then it was so difficult and challenging that I could not bear the pain and I could not sleep. So I had to cry out to God a lot. In my agony, my prayer was not, Father, everything is possible for you. Take this cup from me, yet not what I will, but what will. My prayer stopped in the middle. My prayer is this, everything is possible for you. Take this cup from me. That's it. I didn't pray, yet not what I will, but what you will. Because it was too overwhelming that I did not have any more strength to pray the third prayer. And even it was not possible to think about it for me to pray. And then after for a while, since it was the most trial time in my entire life of faith, and I did not want to have any resentment in my heart, I set up the time of prayer, 40 days of prayer. I never have set up the time to pray in my life except this one, 40 days of prayer. And I had two prayer topics. Number one prayer topic is, what is my sin in dealing with them? What is my sin in dealing with them? I wanted to know my sin so that I might not fall into the same sin again in the future. My number two prayer is, what can I learn about Jesus through this? What can I learn about Jesus through this? Because I learned our life of faith is the process of learning Jesus. So I prayed for these two specific prayer topics 40 days. Around the end of the time, God answered my two prayers in this way. Through the Jeremy Box message during HBF and JBF Bible Cafe in this place. God answered my first prayer topic in this way. What is my sin in dealing with them? Jesus answered, friend, your sins are forgiven. Jesus did not say, I did not have sin. Jesus said, friend, your sins are forgiven. Jesus did not say, I don't have any sin. Jesus said, friend, your sins are forgiven. At the very moment that I heard Jesus' voice, friend, your sins are forgiven, I immediately realized their sins were forgiven too. Jesus answered my second prayer topic, what can I learn about Jesus through this? God answered me in this way. The Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins. What can I learn about Jesus? Jesus has authority on earth to forgive sins. In addition to answering of to my prayers, God revealed to me one more thing. That one came through daily bread. And it is, God heals incurable wounds. God specifically said there is an incurable wounds, but God heals. So through prayer, God restores my spirit, and I have been forgiven, they have been forgiven. There will be a time of restoration because God heals incurable wounds. And Jesus revealed himself as the Son of God who has authority on earth to forgive sins. Today's passage reveals Jesus as the shepherd. As a shepherd, he predicted their failure but planted the hope of restoration. As a shepherd, Jesus shared his life of prayer at the most critical time. As a shepherd, Jesus kept encouraging his disciples to watch and pray. Even after he was crucified and risen again, he came back to his disciples again as their shepherd and began to dwell in their hearts and keep doing the same thing, predicting their failures, planting hope of restoration, showing the example of prayer, and keep encouraging them to watch and pray. Praise Jesus, who is our shepherd. One word, Jesus the shepherd. Let's pray. Our Father in heaven, thank you for sending Jesus as our Lord and Savior. Thank you for blessing us to know Jesus the shepherd. Father, may you bless us to follow his example of prayer as he keep encouraging us to watch and pray. I thank you. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you. Oh, thank you, Pastor John, for a very practical message. Let's pray to put the words of God here into practice. Okay, and we're going to sing hymn 232, Lead Me to Calvary. And now we'll have the closing announcements and prayer from Pastor John.
I learned from the passage that Jesus is the shepherd. As a shepherd, he planted the hope of restoration for the failure of his disciples and showed the example of prayer and kept encouraging his disciples to pray. Personally, I also learned that Jesus said to give up his life, to come into the hearts of his disciples and keep encouraging them to pray. And it was not easy for him to give up his life and sacrifice, but he also did it as a shepherd, and now he's with us, and now he's each one of us and inside of us and work as our personal shepherd, one-to-one shepherd. So through his empowerment and encouragement, and we can follow his example of prayer. In time of trials, instead of despairing or falling into sinful actions, we can come to God and pray persistently, even 3 times or 3 hours, and experience the victory through the power of prayer. Secondly, let's pray to seek the will of God more than anything else. Think about what is God doing. God wants us to experience victory through prayer, according to today's passage. Pandemic time has one great benefit from God, that is, we have more time to pray. Before pandemic came, every day I looked at my schedules. I had many schedules and activities to do. I don't look at my schedule at all these days. Nothing is there. So I have tons of time to pray. So God bless us to have more time to pray. Of course, if you have many children, that may be a little bit different story. But still, you have extra time because you don't drive to your workplace, and you can have the benefit of driving time to your personal time of prayer. One person really impressed me when he talked about the virus situation, when he said that we just wanted to get out of the virus as soon as possible, but that's not good. What we need to do is we need to fully follow the will of God. If we need to be disciplined, let us to be disciplined to the full. Let the will of God be accomplished in our life through coronavirus pandemic. That really moved my heart. It is also related to think about what is God doing. What we want, what we will, is just get out of the virus and go back to the normal life as soon as possible and restore our economy as soon as possible. But what is God doing? We need to think about the will of God and let the will of God be fully experienced in our lives more than anything else, even more than passing the pandemic situation and recovery of our economy. I read 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verse 14. If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and I will forgive their sin and will heal their land. So let's pray to humble ourselves. This is not a time of being proud. This is the time to humble ourselves and pray and seek God's face and turn from our wicked ways. Number 4, let's pray for the protection of medical professionals, healthcare workers, especially our coworkers who are working in the front line of the virus. Number 5, pray for the provision of people around the world who cannot maintain their basic life, especially our coworkers. Number seven, financial offering is our way to store treasure in heaven and also share our blessings with others. Number eight, use our time as a good opportunity to preach Jesus, who is the shepherd. Number nine, humble ourselves and follow government guidelines, including wearing masks and keeping social distancing. It's an act of love for our neighbors because we can be carriers of virus without symptoms. Number 10, pray for government authorities, the president, the governors, mayors, health specialists, that they may make wise decisions. 11, missionary Matthew and Monica live for Austin, Texas, UBF, to support the ministry there. They live on Tuesday, so if you want to send your gift, bring to missionary Maria Kwan. And I'll be a messenger two more weeks. Okay, these are the prayer topics, and let me pray and finish today's service. Our Father in heaven, thank you for sending Jesus as our shepherd. Thank you for planting the hope of restoration. Thank you for showing the example of prayer and keep encouraging us to pray, even coming to us through your Holy Spirit. Father, please bless us to think about what are you doing more than anything else. And we may remember your will and pray for your will to be fully accomplished in our lives during the time of pandemic situation. Father, please humble ourselves and pray and seek your face and turn from our wicked ways. Father, I pray for the protection of medical professionals, healthcare workers, especially our co-workers who are working in the front line of the virus. Father, we pray for your mercy for the provision of people around the world who cannot maintain their basic life, especially our co-workers. Father, please help us to store our treasure in heaven through our offerings and use our time as a good opportunity to preach you as the shepherd. Father, please humble ourselves and follow government guidelines, wearing masks and keeping social distance. And it's as an act of our love for our neighbors. Father, I pray for the President Trump, the governors, the mayors, health specialists, that they may make wise decisions. I pray for missionary Matthew and Monica Kim, grant them joy and mercy as they go to Austin, Texas, UBF to support the ministry there. You may really bless Austin, Texas, UBF through their prayer and devotion and love. Father, I pray that I also may prepare Sunday message two more weeks. I thank you. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
So that will conclude our worship service here and online stream. Thank you, and we'll see you next week.